On the back side of your article, you're going to answer these three questions based upon what you read. Can somebody tell me how someone gets Angelman syndrome? Alan.
The maternal copy of the gene is like mutated or absent, and the dad's copy of the gene is already inactive.
That's right. All right, so here are your two chromosomes. So you get one from mom, that's a maternal, and one from dad, that's a paternal. And so you have this gene, what do they call it? UBE3A. I'm not even sure what that all stands for. All right, so there's a gene, the section of the DNA that codes for making this protein. And as as Madeline said, in order to get this, mom's copy, this gene is mutated. So what does that mean? It means the order of the bases, the A's, T's, C's, and G's, has been changed. And so therefore, that order is what dictates what protein is going to be made. And that protein gives you certain traits and does certain things in the body. So therefore, mom's copy is not making that right protein, and so she's missing it, and therefore you have certain side effects. But dad over here has a normal copy of the gene, and that doesn't seem to matter because, as Madeline said, the dad's copy of the gene gets inactivated. So even though this is a normal copy, it's inactivated, and it doesn't matter because that gene isn't turned on, and therefore you're not going to make the protein. So it's as if you have no copy of the gene that is working, and therefore leading to the disorder or the syndrome, Angelman syndrome. And so, can somebody tell me how a gene becomes inactivated? It was on the last few paragraphs I displayed up here, and also I talked about it in the notes as well. What happens to the genes naturally in this case in the brain? What happens to the genes? How do they become inactivated? Jana? Yeah, it's methylated. So adding methyl groups to it. So they add these chemical, the cell adds these chemical groups to the gene, and that turns the gene off. We're going to learn in a couple of chapters about turning on and off genes. That's a natural thing that we do because certain genes we don't want on all the time. So we turn them off at certain times and turn them on at other times and so on. And adding methyl groups is one way that the cell turns on and off genes. So this is turned off by adding methyl groups. And so therefore, it never is displayed. And so it only affects if the mutation comes from mom's chromosome. If I switched it, would this make, if I switched it like this, and here's mom and dad's chromosome, and this one has the normal copy of the gene, and this one has the, let's say, the mutated copy. Does this person have Angelman syndrome? No, because this is the mutated copy. Your cell is still going to inactivate that gene. So this is the one that becomes inactivated. And in this case, it doesn't really matter because it was a mutated gene in the first place. And now the person has a normal copy of the gene and makes the protein, doesn't have the syndrome. All right, so it matters which one you get it from mom or dad in this case. And so genes in general like this are called what? The group of genes in which one copy, either from the mom or the dad. In this example, it's the dad's copy. It's not always the dad's copy, but in this example, it happens to be. What are they called, Ellie?
Silenced genes.
They are silenced, and then that's right. And then another word for that, they call it imprinted genes as well. And so imprinted genes, this is called genomic imprinting. And so, this is one example in humans. In the notes, I gave you an example of mice. Can somebody relate the mice and how this works with the mice? This is at the very end of your notes. So How does it work with mice? What was the G move? Jana. All right, only the chromosome from dad is expressed, and when this is one of the mice is one of the first organisms they had figured out about genomic imprinting. What was the gene that they were looking at? The size, right? And there was something called, insulin-like growth factor. A growth factor is a molecule that's made that triggers cells to divide and organisms to grow. We as humans, we have human growth hormone that triggers us to divide. We'll talk more about that in later chapters. There are people who are deficient in human growth hormone that do not grow properly. And so that's what's going on with the mouse. And so, if I change the color, let's do red here. So in the mice, instead of the UBE3A gene, it was this growth factor gene. And so they had this growth factor gene here, growth factor gene here. This growth factor gene was inactivated, and they found, just like in us with the Angelman syndrome, that if they had a mutated copy of the growth factor from mom, then that you ended up with dwarf mice. And that's because they didn't make the growth factor. The normal copy was inactivated from dad, and so therefore they didn't make the growth factor, and you got these dwarf little mice. On the flip side, when they flipped it, in this case here, and it had the mutated copy here was inactivated, and you had the normal copy of the growth factor, they found normal mice because they were able to make the growth factor. All right. And lastly, what's the research being done to either help people or prevent Angelman syndrome? Help people with or prevent? What are they doing, Lucas?
Aren't they investigating a topoisomerase inhibitor and trying to use it to reactivate the UBE3A?
That's right. Yeah, they're trying to reactivate that. And so this chemical they tested a whole bunch of chemicals to see if any of them would turn this gene back on after it had been turned off. Because this is, don't look at the red here, this is the people with Angelman syndrome, their one normal copy of the gene. So their thought was, if we can make that turn on, then they can start making the protein, and then they wouldn't be deficient of it, and so on. And so they found that this drug actually interferes with the methylation and interferes with those chemical groups and reactivates that gene. The question, though, is when can you do that? Because do you have to do it in the very early stages, like when the baby is an embryo, and activate that gene to start making that protein? Is an imperative that protein is made early on in development? Or can you have a baby that has been diagnosed with Angelman syndrome and activate their genes as already, millions of cells big, and reverse the effects? Or is it too late when they're already, born and diagnosed? So there's a lot of research being done on that. They haven't yet moved to human, they haven't got far enough to even move to human trials on that. So they're still doing some research in mice on that. Okay? So I just want to give you an example of genomic imprinting, and real life research is pretty out there, isn't it?
Oh, no.
I see everybody looking out there, so everybody look out. Ooh,
it's snowing.
It's snowing like 8 hours ago. We've been home right now.
Yeah. It looks like it's a really pretty snow, doesn't it?
It looks really nice.
It's really crowded.
Yeah.
Really.
Although it's, sometimes it's misleading here because it's like the wind is like in the little courtyard thing, so it may not be.
We're supposed to
get
a flash snowstorm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, I am going to collect this, so put your name on it and pass it forward, please. And then I'd like you to turn your attention to the second sheet that you picked up that says solving linkage and crossing over problems.
I have a
poem.
definitely cover it. Oh, it was growth hormone.
So that's
front and back of linked and unlinked, the same crosses, but how you differ in results having linked versus unlinked genes. And hopefully you watched the video last night because I went through the explanation of the linked part of it. That was the beginning of the video last night. So what we're going to look at next is, now that you've seen linked versus unlinked and how to tell what you'd expect if the cross was linked or unlinked, one of the skills that you need to have is to be able to look at an unknown problem and look at the results of a genetic cross and what's the ratio you get and determine whether those two genes in the problem are linked or unlinked. All right, so therefore that's what this sheet is about. So the front side is just a synopsis of how to do that. So I'm going to have you spend a minute and read the front side of that.
Yeah, come on.
let's start with where we left off. Yesterday, what we did in class yesterday. So, these two crosses, and we assumed that they were unlinked, all right? And when we did that, you got all heterozygous kids. And then when we crossed the heterozygous with, did that test cross with all recessive, we got a 1:1:1:1 ratio, all right? So that's, with that particular cross, that's what we would expect if they were unlinked. Then on the flip side, you did the expectation of what you would get if they were linked. So these are on the same chromosome. So that first cross, when you cross the homozygous individuals, you still end up at the end of the first cross with all heterozygous kids. But the thing is that those heterozygous kids have these two chromosomes. They got the one with the pluses from this parent, and the one, the B and the BG chromosome from this parent. So they're linked on the same gene. Are on the same chromosome, and so therefore now when you cross those heterozygous individuals with the homozygous, now this heterozygous, instead of having four combinations like in the unlinked, because when they're unlinked, they can pass a B plus and a BG plus because they're on two different chromosome pairs, and so therefore they passed just one of each chromosome number one and chromosome two. So therefore there was four different combinations that they could pass. That's where we got these four here. When they're linked on the same chromosome pair, now we only have two choices to pass on, the B plus and the BG plus, or the B and the BG. And therefore that's where we get only those two choices. And then this parent is still the same. They can pass on this one or this one, but both of them have a B and a BG. And that's where we get a 1:1:1 ratio. And so we get a different result if they're linked versus unlinked. But remember that at the bottom of the linked thing yesterday, that I said that Morgan actually did this experiment. He did these exact crosses, and these were his results. His results were not like the linked or the unlinked. Now, he got all four phenotypes similar to the unlinked, but they weren't in a 1:1:1:1 ratio. And so he got way less of the black and normal and the gray and the vestigial. He did get the most like this linked one where it was a 1:1 ratio. So what happens is that this is how Morgan discovered linked genes as well as the role of crossing over in getting new combinations. So what he found was that these two right here, the gray and normal and the black and vestigial, these guys here, that's the 1:1 ratio that we would expect with linked genes. But yet he found a handful of two combinations that didn't seem possible, but they are possible if crossing over occurs. So in the notes yesterday I drew, if crossing over occurs between, if this parent right here, all right, the chromosomes replicate, so here's the replicated chromosome with the B plus and the BG plus, and here's the replicated chromosome with the B and the BG, and they switch and cross over, let's say they switch the BG genes here. Now, when meiosis 2 occurs, so the meiosis 1 is the mother chromosome separate, meiosis 2 is the sister chromatid separate, and so now, it's like these four right here would be the four possible egg or sperm cells that that parent could make. Now, all of a sudden, with crossing over, you have the B plus and the BG gene that can be inherited together. Without crossing over, that wasn't a combination that was available to be passed on to the kids. But now it is. And same thing with the B and the BG plus. Now that's a combination that's available to be passed on to the kids. So therefore, what has happened is when you get linked genes, it's very rarely like this 1:1 ratio because crossing over could occur between the genes. And so therefore, if you see the overwhelmingly a higher percentage of your kids showing what you would expect in the linked genes, but just a handful of the combinations you couldn't see unless crossing over occurs, that's your clue that those genes are linked, but crossing over has occurred, and that explains why you can see the other two phenotypes that wouldn't have been possible before. Does that make sense? All right. And so so that's what you're looking for in this sheet that I would like you to look at now. So if you look at the back side of it, so the front side was kind of trying to explain that. So the back side, it has 1 through 6 kind of steps. I've already kind of talked to you about 1 through 4. If you look at number 5 and 6, I've talked about that in the notes yesterday. So 5 says the percent of CO. CO stands for crossing over. So yesterday in the notes, I went over an example with Morgan's fruit flies about how he got the percent of crossing over. It also tells you there how to do that. And it tells you that that is one map unit of distance between genes. So what I'd like you to do is look at just number 1 on there and look at the information and tell if the genes are linked or unlinked. All right. Do not do number 2. Number 2 gets into a genetic concept called epistasis, which I don't have to teach you, so I'm not going to. So we're okay with number 2. All right.
So we just cross out.
So you can just cross out number 2. Okay. You're dying to know what talks about in your textbooks.
Dying to learn more biology, but more genes.
That's right. Okay.
Let's go over this. Together. Now has 4 possibilities because they're going to pass N and a little H because they're both the same on both pairs of chromosomes. So little N and a little H, you get the 1:1:1:1 ratio. So therefore, when they did this cross, this was their results, 93 and 97, showing the big N little H's and little N big H's. And then these two are due to crossing over. And so you should have, are these guys linked? You should have the answer yes. And the reason why is because A, you didn't get a 1:1:1 ratio. You did get all four phenotypes, but you got the majority in the two that you would expect with not crossing over. And so therefore, these two types were due to crossing over. How do I figure out the percent of crossing over? I total these up, 10 recombinants or 10 divided by my total, which is 200 offspring, multiplied by 100, we get a 5% crossing over. All right, and so therefore, did you get a 1:1 ratio? No, and the other two questions were repeated, so 5%. So I meant to wipe those out. So it's excellent. Okay, so it looks like we're going to run out of time tomorrow at the very beginning of the class. I want to relate this to genes and mapping genes on a chromosome. All right, so that's where we'll start tomorrow, and then I'm going to teach you that chi-square stuff, which is the package. So it's not homework.
All right. Chi-square.
Chi-square, most people won't know how to do that unless you take stats, and so...
Or D.
And so I need to teach you that. Bye, Ashley.